I was going to teach this. This is a teaching message, not a preaching message. I was going to teach this the week before Brother Sharp came as a preparation for what he was going to do. Had real bad weather, icy roads, and basically almost should have called church off, but we did that night. Few people here made it, but so I'm doing this now instead of then. God has made you some promises. If you're here this morning, number one, if you're here and lost, he has promised you this: all that call unto me, I will in no wise cast out. God says this promise. He said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's a promise. That is God giving his word to you. And God saying, I give you my word. And God is not a liar, and God does not renege, and God doesn't crawfish, and God doesn't change his mind. And God has said, all that come to me, I will in no wise, what? Cast out. Are you listening to me? God said this. This is his word. Used to in America, we said that a man's word was his bond. We said the man is no better than his word. And I think we ought to get back to that. I think we tell people stuff. We ought to. And if we messed up and sinned, as we're not God, we're human beings. But if we messed up and didn't keep our word, then we ought to make amends for that, admit that, and try to rectify that as best that we can. But I'm glad today that we serve a God who never lies, who never exaggerates, who never stretches it out, who never overpromises. I so appreciated the Sunday school class this morning. Brother Tim taught about the nature of God and how God deals with his children and what we are as his children. One of the reasons I want to teach this today is this. Nations and families and individuals are affected. You are today. The enjoyments, blessings that you experience as an American are affected by a nation, by a family, by an individual, by your individual attitude and your view concerning the nation Israel and the Jewish people. Whether you understand that or like it or not, you are affected by it. You're affected by your forefathers' attitude toward the Jewish people and Israel as a nation. You are either blessed or cursed by your attitude toward that. And you will experience in generational form the blessings of that. I want God's blessing on myself. I want God's blessing on my family, my descendants, and I want God's blessing on America. Satan has ever hated the Jewish people. For it was through the Jewish bloodline that Messiah was promised, Abraham. And Satan has always tried to destroy the seed that was promised from Genesis chapter 3. He's always tried to destroy the godly seed. And that seed, that messianic seed, was through Jesus Christ in Jewish lineage. Okay? Through the nation of Israel. There is a false and satanic doctrine that is being taught in America. And it has literally swept through America in the last 15 years at an alarming speed. I can't change what everybody else in America is preaching, but I'm going to preach to you people the truth of God's word. And I'm going to do good to your families and to your descendants by preaching and teaching what I'm going to teach today. This false doctrine, this satanic doctrine, teaches three things. Number one, it teaches that God is done with Israel. He is done with the Jew that we see recorded here in the Old Testament and even in the Gospels, and that God has cast them away forever and he's done with them. And so the land of Israel does not belong to them, nor does all the promises of the Bible that God promised them belong to them. Number two is a false teaching that the church has replaced Israel. In other words, God, first of all, has cast them away, and that he has received the church and he has replaced Israel with the church. That is a lie. It is not true. Thirdly, this is a sidekick, I call it, of the false doctrine being taught, that the Jews, and this is where it gets real dicey, that the Jews in Israel are not Jewish people. But the true Jewish people are what's called British Israelites, Caucasians who move through Great Britain over here into America, and they try to teach you that you are the Jews, that Gentiles are the Jews. That's where you get this British Israelite. And it, by the way, it's thick right here in Norwood. And it's more prevalent than you would think for. And they say they are Jews and that the Jews over there are not Jews. I've always asked him, which tribe are you? I never had one answer me yet because he don't know. And they take that from what they take this little statement, the 10 lost tribes of Israel. And there's not 10. You cannot find that in the Bible. There are not 10 lost tribes in the Bible. That's a man-made concoction to try to replace the Jewish people with Gentile people and or some conception of a church to them. It's called stolen identity. And all these three wrapped up false doctrines have done something to America. It has caused America to turn away from Israel. It is being taught in churches. By the way, Catholic doctrine, the whole basis of Catholic doctrine is that the Catholic Church teaches that they have replaced Israel, thus their hatred for the Jewish nation down through the centuries, justifying their killing of Jews in Europe for years. Hitler was a Catholic. Hitler had a concordor with the Catholic Church during World War II. The Catholic hierarchy rejoiced in Hitler's slaughter of the Jewish people. Those are facts. That's not just Mickey Mouse pulpit stuff. And this doctrine of replacement of the Jews, Hitler's SS soldiers wore on their belt buckle in God We Trust. And they believed that it was their duty, because of this false doctrine, to destroy the Jewish people. They called, in the Crusades, they called them Christ killers. One of the reasons that Jewish people have the attitude that they have toward Christianity is because their framework and understanding of Christianity is Catholicism. And Catholicism massacred Jewish people during the Crusades by the tens of thousands, wiped out entire villages in the name of Jesus Christ. And so you see that attitude. This is serious, as it has ruined nations. This theology arose in Germany. It took over German theology and Protestant, and in, of course, was already in the Catholic churches. And it permeated the country of Germany so much that when a leader came up, Hitler, who took that theology and said, you know what? You guys are a bunch of cowards. You're just preaching it in the churches, but I'm going to put it in the political. I'm going to put it into political practice. And you know what it did? It ruined that nation. And Dresden and other cities of Germany were bombed and obliterated. And children died in the flames because they embraced a theology of hatred and disdain for and rejection of Israel and the Jewish people. It's not funny business to mess with the apple of God's eye. Britain was the greatest world power on the globe through the 18th century and up into the 19th century. The sun never set on British soil. Britain had been a friend of Israel. God had blessed them. They were a people who believed the book. They produced preachers such as Charles Spurgeon and some of the greatest theologians, and the great doctrinal issues that became part of the American political scene came out of a Britain that embraced the scriptures and the understanding of Israel's place in history. But Israel was infected. But Britain, England, was infected with replacement theology and anti-Jewish theology. And here's how it got footing in their political system. England had a fleet, the largest, has always been a naval country. They don't have a lot of land, but their fleets were worldwide. Their fleets depended upon oil, Arab oil. Whenever General Allenby conquered Palestine or the land of Israel in 1917 in World War I, he had such a Christian background in him that he was riding a white horse, and they were still on horses and cavalry in those days. And when he got to Jerusalem and his soldiers who had conquered it ahead of him, he dismounted from his white horse and said, "I will not ride a horse where my Savior bore my cross for my sin." This was a major general of the Britain army making a worldwide, unabashed, unashamed statement of the supremacy of Jesus Christ, of the importance of the nation Israel, the importance of what happened there. But after 1917, between that time and World War II, Britain sold out their faith in scriptures for oil. When the Arabs began to pull back the oil and said, we'll not sell you oil as long as you support the Jews, they put out an issue called the White Papers. And the White Papers was an edict that they would no longer favor Israel, that they would favor the Arab Muslims for the oil. They had what's called the Balfour Declaration. And the Balfour Declaration decreed that the land of Israel should be given back to the Jewish people. Now, this is after 1900 years. And this land is, you heard Brother Sharp say last week, is far, far larger than what they have today. But in the course of those few years between World War I and World War II, England reneged on the Balfour Declaration, took it, they backed up and said, we wash our hands of it like Pilate did, gave it to the United Nations, and the United Nations partitioned Israel, gave them a little slice of what they really had coming scripturally, and gave the Arabs the rest of it to appease the Arabs. And the Arabs did not accept that and have not accepted that to this day. That's why Yasser Arafat and everybody in the Palestinian movement and all the other Arab nations say they will not be satisfied until the last drop of Jewish blood has been shed and the Jews are driven into the Mediterranean Sea and they dominate and control all of the Mideast. And that's not just the Mideast they want us too. And so Israel was born in 1948, a nation born May 14th, 1948. They took it because it was the first time in 2,000 years they had their land back. And so nations, now I say this and close out, said all that, say this, England, because they turned their back on Israel when Israel needed them the most, is now a bankrupt island being overrun by Muslims off the coast of Europe. I am telling you this, and I could go all morning showing you nation after nation after nation after nation after nation after nation and people after people after people and family after family and after family. And you say, well, Reggie, I know so-and-so and it hadn't happened yet. Just hang on. God's a lot more long-suffering than you are and a lot more patient than you are. God's judgment wheel grinds exceedingly slow, but it grinds exceedingly fine. God will take care of it. And I want, and by the way, the last battle that's going to be fought on the face of this earth is going to be a battle between all the nations of the world gathered around the little nation Israel to destroy them. And guess who's going to come out on top? God is going to come out on top with Israel. You know who what? I want to be on the side of God when this thing's over with. We now have a president who is anti-Israel. No use of making any bones about it. No use hedging about it going on. He knows how to dance and sing the song when he needs to. But in his heart, he's an Israel despiser. He's a Jew hater. He's adept at using Jewish liberals. He understands them. We have a president who is pro-Muslim. You have never seen Obama bow to the prime minister of Israel, but he has bowed to Arab kings and leaders. Now, I'll tell you something. I'm too far down the road. 33 years ago yesterday, I surrendered to preach. And I recommitted myself to God. Lord, if you'll give me the grace, I'll just keep on. I talked to my wife yesterday. I am no preacher. I do not preach hard. There are many people in this country who think I'm rough and coarse and all stuff. They don't even have a clue. I have never even preached to you people what I read in this book, for I know something. If I were to preach what I really know is in this book, half you wouldn't be back next Sunday. Did you know that? I told Karen yesterday evening, I said, I fear to stand before God because I have been a coward to preach some things because I know it would offend people. And you think I've preached tough. There are verses in this Bible that face the issues that we're facing today in America that no preacher I know of on the planet is preaching today. And I'm saying to you this, that I don't want to dance around the subject. We have a pro-Muslim president. I believe he has been given to America as a judgment because of our turning the backs on the Word of God. One of the things that happens when a nation turns its back on the Word of God, it will soon turn its back on the nation of Israel. We have a president who is ignorant of the Bible, and thus his ignorance of curse, the curse that will come upon us by turning against Israel. As I said, we have mainline Protestant churches, Catholic churches who believe and teach that Israel has replaced the church. Right now, if you turn your ear and listen carefully, you can hear across the major colleges and universities of America that they have pro-Palestinian groups that are constantly threatening Jewish groups. They're having staging demonstrations, sit-ins, and signage carries and stuff like that, issuing their support. And this goes from California to New York. Groups that are pro-Palestinian and pro-Muslim, anti-Israel, claiming that Israel is an apartheid state, that they're dominating the Palestinian people and treating them terrible. Jimmy Carter is one of the worst absolute people in the world, a Jew hater. There's never been anybody in prominence of America that man is doing. He makes the most awful statements against the Jewish people in Israel you've ever heard in your life. I tell you what, it's going to be a dark day at judgment. The last great conflict, as I said, will be a battle between the nations of this world and tiny Israel. But God is going to see to it. God is going to win that battle. Israel won't win it. God will win it. That's when the sky will split and he'll come. Amen. And finally, I want you to get this today. Please, everyone, listen very carefully to me. I so appreciated, again, the Sunday school class because of the nature of God. Tim talked about falling down and getting up and falling down and getting up and not going back to the starting line, but getting up and going on and getting up. And our Heavenly Father not throwing us away because we fell down the race. Listen to me very carefully right now. This book is chunk full of promises to the little nation of Israel and the Jewish people. And you're going to be looking at some of them here pretty soon. And this is what locked me in concrete about my support for Israel. That if our Heavenly Father, the God of this book, does not keep every single promise to the nation of Israel and the Jewish people, how can I expect him to keep his promises to me? And I'm telling you this morning, that if I believe God will keep his promises to Reggie, I better believe he'll keep his promises to Israel. For let me tell you something. The first thing that you're going to look at here today, look at number one, the covenants of God with Israel. Now, we're talking about the restoration of Israel. Why do we even mention the subject, the restoration of Israel? Because Israel was not a nation for 2,000 years. After AD 70, Titus destroyed Jerusalem, scattered the Jewish people across the face of the earth. Israel was not a nation for 2,000 years. May the 14th, 1948. But why? God had promised in the past by the prophets. Now I'm going to give you something to do. This will be a blessing to you. Sister DeGase has been here since back in Methuselah's time. Sister DeGase, in the early years of her attending this church, I found out that she loved the book of Isaiah. Am I right or not? This lady will tell you something, that if you want a blessing, you want God to give you sweet nuggets of truth that will sustain you and take you through all the problems of life, read the book of Isaiah. Now I'm going to give you a project. When you start in Isaiah, Isaiah is the first prophet, and you get in the books of the prophets. Read through the prophets and don't worry about what you don't understand. Just say, Lord, speak to me, and read. And especially the little books, read them. You're living in a time when you need to be, you can read the future in advance if you will read those books. But here's the thing I want to say to you. God promised in those books that Israel would be a nation forever. All right? If they're not going to be a nation forever, and God pulled back on that, as many churches are teaching, then maybe when God said, I give unto thee eternal life. You know what I found out, Brother Dean? Most of them that's teaching that he didn't do what he said he'd do for Israel don't believe he'll do what he said he'd do for me and you either. They don't believe in eternal life either. They believe God says he saves you, gives eternal life, but then you can lose it. No wonder they believe that. They don't believe God's kept his word to anybody about anything for all time. And I wouldn't worship a God who can't tell the truth or keep his word. You listen to me today, God keeps his word. Let's begin getting your Bibles now. And we're going to go to the number one, the covenants of God with Israel. Now, Brother Paul, here's what I want you to do. At noon sharp, I want you to turn that police light on. I tell you what, don't cops get to you. He can't even come to church without a light. Appreciate you, brother. By the way, There's been different people in church that's talked to me about, boy, they'd like to go to Israel with Brother Sharp. You ought to go if you can. Okay? I don't have the money to help you, but go. But God wants you to go. He'll make a way. But I'm telling you this, it'd be a blessing to you. And you get more going with him than most deals I've ever seen in my life. So anyway, number one, the covenants with Israel. What is a covenant? That's what you did when you got married. Oh, you said, I made a contract. No, you didn't. Now, let me throw something at you. Who instituted marriage? God decided what marriage is. Man, woman. By the way, can somebody define marriage to me? Define marriage to me. That's right. One man, one woman for what? Lifetime. When your spouse passes away, then you're free to remarry, right? That's it. That is the Bible. Okay? Covenant, look, God promised to give the land to Israel. Covenant is a promise. It's giving your word. You stand up here, you know, do you thus and thus and thus, and you say, I do. Do you thus and thus and thus and thus? I will. What are you doing? You are giving your word. You are giving your promise. This is what it means to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, that we become people who do what we say we will do. We keep our word. God promised to give the what? The land to Abraham and his seed forever. Some of you watch the news, you wonder, what in the world are they fighting about over there? What's going on over there? Well, that's about the land, and God promised the land to the Israel people, and he said he land to Abraham and his seed forever, and that's in Genesis chapter 13. Let's just turn there and read it real quick, and we get our Bibles open, and you mark these verses as we go along. Genesis chapter 13 and verse number 14, the Bible said, and the Lord said unto Abram after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward and southward, eastward and westward, for all the land which thou seest to thee will I give it, and to thy seed for how long? Forever. Forever. So whose land does that belong to over there? Who's that land belong to? Abraham's seed, and the seed is in Isaac, not in Ishmael. You read your Bible, okay? So he promised it forever. Go to Genesis chapter 15. You'll need to change that to verse number 18. In Genesis chapter 15, verse number 18. And the same day the Lord made a what with Abram? A covenant, saying, unto thy seed have I given what? This land from the river Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. And he goes ahead and describes, and you can find out the whole deal. If you read your Bible, you can find out the dimensions and the boundary lines of it all. And it's big, all right? It's a lot bigger than what they have now. But anyway, he said, I have given this land. Let's go down number B. There are number one in the covenants. God promised. So first of all, God promised to give them a what? Tell me, what is it? What is it? The land. Second, God promised to make the people, Israel, his own nation forever. And you can read these scriptures. I want you to take this one. I want you to keep this in the Bible. Go home, do a Bible study. For time's sake, I'm not going to turn to all these. But here's the first thing. He promised to give them the land forever. Second of all, he said, forever you will be my special people through which the Messiah will come, and the Jewish people will be a nation forever. There's not that said about any other nation in the world, but that the Jewish people will be a nation especially under God forever. Number three or C there, God promised to give them a king who would reign over them forever. By the way, just turn to 2 Samuel chapter 7 right now. 2 Samuel chapter 7. Would somebody say, Reggie, quit trying to preach and teach because you can't do all this. I'll get in a big preaching mode, and then first thing I know I'm off. I want to slow down. I want to get this. Visitors, we're glad you're with us today, and we hope and pray that God will speak to your heart and minister to your life today, and that you'll worship him while you're here. 2 Samuel chapter 7, and let's look at verse number 24. For thou hast confirmed thyself to thy people Israel to be a people unto thee for how long? Forever. And thou, Lord, art become their God. I want you to look at verse number 13. Now about he's promised a king. There's going to be a king forever. He shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom. How long? Forever. Now here's what's happening. You say, well, Israel ain't even been a nation for 2,000 years. Yeah, they are. They're just not back in the land. They ain't had land for 2,000 years. Yeah, they do. God said it's still theirs. He said, they ain't even been a people. Yeah, they did. They're still theirs. And they say, well, they ain't had a king. Yeah, they do. They got a King Jesus. How many knows that the throne of David is, Jesus Christ is in the lineage of David. They have all these things. And so here's three things that God promised in his covenant with Israel forever. The land, that he would be that they would be a special people. And finally, that they would have a king that would reign over them forever. By the way, you're not going to get to vote in the millennial reign, and you're not going to get to vote in the kingdom, the eternal kingdom. Jesus is going to be king. He makes all the decisions. You ain't even got to worry about it. All right, now, let's look at this. This is so good. Everybody, number one, there it says, these covenants were unconditional. That means that, what does it mean to have an unconditional covenant? How many of you got married and made a, what kind of covenant did you make when you got married? What were your vows like? What did you say? I will be faithful unto you through, let's, somebody help me. You think I'd get them, but many times I've done it. In sickness and in health, for rich or for poor, for better or for worse, until, wait a minute. As far as Americans are concerned, that's nothing but a bunch of mush and nonsense. What do we talk until death do us part? Ain't nobody means that anymore. You know what I want to do? I want to rebuild the generations. Hey, kids, when you say it, mean it. When you say it, mean it. You see, the covenants, the marriage ceremony that you do now was back when America was a Christian nation. And we knew what an unconditional covenant was. That means we didn't put conditions in it. Now, let me tell you something. If you're going to put conditions in it, at least be honest. Come up here and say, now, preacher, these are the vows we want. I had a woman one time who wanted me to do a wedding. I hadn't been preaching too long, and I'm dumber than a box of rocks now. And I'll tell you what, I'm dumber than a trainload of rocks then. And I got up there, and she started telling me things are going to be in the vows. And I started reading them, and I said, this ain't going to work. And what she had done was put a bunch of conditions in her vows. But you know what? I look back at it now, and I say, at least she was honest. At the time, I thought, you old heifer. Ain't that terrible? I thought, I'm going to go talk to the old boy and tell him, run! But at least she was being honest. And you ought to be honest. If you don't mean it, don't come up here and say, at least say, you know what? We're not going to say unconditional covenant here. We're going to have a conditional covenant. And I'm going to look him right in the eye and say, okay, bozo, the first time you get off and up mad at me, I'm leaving. This is for better, for worse, richer, poorer, sickness, death, until you get mad at me. You as well not unpack your suitcase, honey. Amen. So what I'm saying is we're getting up here and we're lying out our teeth. We're acting. But the Bible wants that. That a true marriage is unconditional covenants. Till death do us part. That is an unconditional covenant. That's a biblical covenant. Now, God has conditional covenants, but this is not one of them. All right. Remember, he is married to Israel. Christ is married to the church. I'll give you something to blow your mind. The wife is bound to her husband so long as he liveth. That's why some wives kill their husbands. So they're loose from the law of their husbands. I mean, that's why, you know, they put arsenic on, you know, fingernails and that kind of stuff. But anyway, boy, that got off bad, didn't it? I don't even know where I was at now. This is terrible. But this conditional covenant thing, you know what? Unconditional. Now, here's the big deal. All right, you got a lady here and a man here, and they're saying, here's what God is saying. I now know where I was at. Christ, the church. All right? Watch this. The wife is bound to the husband so long as he liveth. How long is the church bound to her husband? For long as he liveth. How long does Christ live? He's eternal. Oh, bless my heart. If that don't give you eternal security, I never knew nothing would. All right? Your husband ain't going to die on you. Your spiritual husband, okay? Now, here's the thing. God gives unconditional covenants. Look at read this with me. God said, I will, quote. And if you want to do an interesting study, study what the Bible says when every time God says, I will. I will. I will. God did not say, watch this now. God didn't say, all right, Israel, I'm going to give you this land. I'm going to make you my special people. I'm going to give you a king forever if you do this. Now, there are some things that the blessings that he gave with conditions, but not these covenants. understand the difference between the blessings that God gives in condition and the covenants that without condition. God said, I'm going to do it, and it doesn't matter what you... This, Timmy, this gets back so much to your message, it's unbelievable. You know what God is saying to Israel? You may backslide, you may sin, and they did. You may depart from me, and they did. You may go worship idols, and they did. But I'm still going to do what I said I would do with you. You will always be my special people, and you may get 40 mile out yonder, but I'm going to bring you back. Hey, child of God, listen to me. Grace is the mother and nurse of holiness and not the apologist for sin. But I don't know anybody, and I've never met anybody that lived and done what they ought to do every day of their life. I've never met anybody that didn't backslide to some extent. I've never met anybody that didn't do what you said you were going to do to some extent. And if you think you haven't, you are a self-deceived, self-righteous idiot. But he hasn't left you. And he's still there. And your salvation covenant is unconditional. And if that don't make... Someday that'll make you happy. Someday when you've fallen in the mud hole so many times... I was talking to a man this past week, and he said, Reggie, he said, I used to be involved in a religious movement. And he said, I used to listen to you on the radio. And he said, you'd be preaching. He said, I'd hear you preaching this stuff and about sin. And he said, you was mentioning sins that I never heard mentioned at church, you know, and stuff that, and he said, I went to some of the guys in church, and I said, well, what about this? And he said, I've been at your place, and I've seen you get mad at your wife, and you and her get into it right there at your place. And he said, well, that's different. That's not really sin. What happens to you is you start redefining sin, and the things you're doing are no longer sin. And that's deep, deep hypocrisy. That's a terrible condition to get into. All right. The best thing will ever happen to you is get honest about your sin. Don't call it anything else but sin. Call it what it is. For if you don't, you will not get the grace of God and the blood of Christ to apply to that sin. You will not get relief from that sin nor victory over that sin. It's very dangerous not to be truthful. Behold, thou desirest truth in inward parts. But here's the wonderful part about it is, Donnie, when I've messed up and done that which I said I would never do, when I've failed God, I mean, I don't know what's going to happen next week. I may bail out on God, but God has given me an unconditional covenant. He said, I will do it. And it's not dependent upon Reggie's performance. I'm saved by grace. By grace. By grace I'm saved. And I will not camp with the people who believe it's grace plus anything else. Amen. I'm just saved by his grace. If his grace doesn't take me home, I will not get there. I mean that. The greatest day you'll ever have, you just throw up the white flag and say, dear God, I'm a wicked, hell-deserving sinner, and I thank you for the Son that sacrificed his precious blood in my... I'll tell you, you'll fall more and more in love with Jesus than you ever have. Well, God said, I will without imposing any conditions. Israel's failure did not annul the covenants, but postponed the enjoyment of them. You know what happens when you and I sin? We're just putting off the blessing. We're just losing what we could have had. And God wants the best. Israel must be restored to fulfill the covenants. And Psalms 89. Now turn there. It looks like we're going to get at least one of these done this morning. I tell you what, it's hard for a preacher not to preach. Did you know that? Psalms 89. Everybody go there. Now listen. How many knows this? That there's going to be, the church is going to be raptured out. The tribulation is coming in. After the tribulation, there's the millennial reign. Right? Then the eternal kingdom, right? All right, you've got Ezra, the return to the land, the Jewish people. You've got Nehemiah, return to the land. The Gentile bride is taken out in the book of Esther, replaced with the Jewish bride. Then you've got Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, and then you've got what? Job is the tribulation period, 42 chapters, 4.5 years, the great tribulation, 3.5 years, the great tribulation. And then you have the book of Psalms. After the tribulation, friend, you have the kingdom. And when you're reading the book of Psalms, you're reading about the kingdom. Primarily, you're reading about the kingdom and the king in the book of Psalms. All right? That's its primary deal. Let's look at it. Psalms chapter 89, verse number 3. I have made a covenant. There it is. With my chosen, I have sworn unto David, my servant. Thy seed will I establish how long? Forever, and build up thy throne to all generations. I want you to go to verse 27. I will make him my firstborn higher than the kings of the earth. See that? Now this is a prophetic reference to the Lord Jesus Christ as King of kings and Lord of lords, the son of David, the seed of David. My mercy will I keep for him forevermore, and my covenant shall stand fast with him. There's that word covenant again. His seed also will I make to endure how long? And that means, folks, that the Israeli nation is going to last forever. And his throne as the days of heaven. If his children forsake my law, here it is, and walk not in my judgments, if they break my statutes and keep not commandments, didn't they do that? Land, they did that just when they got out of Egypt. They got on there to Mount Sinai and worshiping a calf and dancing and having a time. They had been redeemed by blood, by the way. They had been saved, by the way. And the first thing they was doing is doing something they said they'd never do. Now watch this, verse 32. He said, if, verse 30, here it is. See, these are the blessings. This is not the covenant, but the blessing. If his children forsake my law, walk not my statutes, break my statutes, keep not my covenant, then will I visit their transgression with the rod and their iniquity with stripes. Nevertheless, my loving kindness will I not utterly take from them, nor suffer my faithfulness to fail. My covenant will I not break. God said, you may get away from me. You may get gone. You may get in a heathen country. But I'll never, never, never break my covenant, which is to make you my people, to give you that land, to make you my my son your king. Going last. Now, take that to the church and take the principle of God's character to that. How many of you have ever backslid? Raise your hand since you got saved. I'll tell you what, let's do. Let's make it real easy. Those of you who have not backslid, please stand. Okay. Now I want to ask you this question. On a scale of 1 to 500, how many have backslid to number 10? Okay, you backslid. Now 1 to 500. Okay. On a scale of 1 to 500, how many have backslid to 50? Okay, there are some few. How many backslid to 200? Okay. You say, Reggie, you believe in backsliding? Not only believe in it, practice it. Not voluntarily, but I practice it. Backsliding is getting away from God. That's what it is. Backsliding is a child who just wants to be away from his father. How many's backslid on, say 300? On a scale of 1 to 500, you've backslid. Dean's, just leave your hand up, Dean, would you? Because Dean's raising his hand over there. How many's backslid? On a scale of 1 to 500, how many's backslid to 400? Okay. How many's backslid on a scale of 1 to 500? 500. You got plumb off where you said you wouldn't. You did, you never would do. Oh, man. Isn't that sight? And I want to give you some wonderful news today. That if you've been born again, the Spirit of God, you might do that, but God will visit you. He'll do just what he does with the nation of Israel. Nevertheless, my loving kindness, verse 33, will not utterly take from him. Boy, isn't it something, a Heavenly Father who's going to love you when you're off in places and doing things that you ought not be. Isn't that something? And nor suffer my faithfulness to fail. You know, Karen and I was driving down the road, I think this week, I forget, we talk a lot, visit, and I enjoy it, and I hope she does. But we was talking about, I said, honey, it's easy to get up and preach on drinking, adultery, sucking them cigarettes. You know, it's easy to get up and preach on these, you know, these sins that people... But it's another thing to get up and preach on attitudes, anger, self-righteousness, pride. That's stuff that we hide behind the wall of our false spirituality. I said, I hope someday I can get to where I can preach on the real deal. But you know, you don't preach on the real deal until you start living the real deal. But I'm glad that God still loves me, Brother Phil, when I've gotten to where I said I would never be. Now, here's what he's done. Here's what he'll do. He said, I won't suffer my faithfulness to fail. Did you notice my faithfulness, God said? Not your faithfulness, but it's his faithfulness. Can I tell you this morning? If you're genuinely been born again, the Spirit of God, and you are a child of God, not a false professor now. A big difference there. Heaven and hell is the difference between that. But if you're genuinely saved, I don't care how far back you go, God's going to go after you. God will not suffer his faithfulness. And God's going to take you to heaven, and you're going to lose rewards for all of eternity. but God's going to take you where he said he would take you. If he gave you eternal life, he'd give it to you. And God don't lie. And I'm not letting anybody in this world call God a liar to this old preacher. He promised me eternal life. Now watch verse 34. He said, my covenant will I not break nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Once I have sworn by my holiness that I will not lie unto David. His seed shall endure forever, his throne as the sun before me. It shall be established forever as the moon, as a faithful witness in heaven. I'm telling you something, folks, listen. You may get chastised, you may get whooped from here to Dixie and back, but God's going to accomplish and do in your life what he said he would do. How many has experienced that? I mean, I'm telling you what, God will whoop you. If you haven't been chastised, you ain't been saved very long is all I can tell you. Let's look at number two, the first dispersion and the restoration. Because of their sins, the nation was sent into captivity. Most of you are familiar with that. Israel, which was now you've got a divided nation. Israel at this point is the 10 northern tribes. And Judah is the two southern tribes, okay? And they were both taken into captivity, but at different time frames. B, there was a partial return to the land. Now, here's where you get into this thing is dicey. They say, well, now the Jew, that's already been fulfilled because the Jews went back into the land in the time of Nehemiah and Ezra. That is true, but only partially. And the prophets' prophecies were not fulfilled in any way, shape, or form at that time. In fact, you look at the number C there, this return did not fulfill the great prophecies because the predicted blessings were not then enjoyed. The predictions of restoration were made after this return. Now, this is why you need to read all those post-exile prophets. When they came back to the land, you still had prophets writing all them guys from Jeremiah on. Most of those guys, not all of them, but most of those guys were post-exile. So how could the prophecies be fulfilled if they were written after this partial return? It's future. So you can't jump that in that. All right. Number three, the second dispersion. The reason, now they had a second dispersion. They were dispersed back there in their captivity, the first dispersion, but they had a second dispersion. And that dispersion took place in AD 70. Remember Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24 or 23 and 24, he said, not a stone will be left upon the building here. And he said, all be tore down. And in AD 70, Titus came in there, razed the city down, and the Jews were scattered. By the way, think about this. In the book of James, do you know what it literally says? To the 12 tribes scattered abroad. I'm telling you what, this Bible is so accurate. Take it for what it says. It means what it says, okay? They're scattered abroad. So after Christ, the reason, the second dispersion, their rejection of Christ, and the Israel nation was scattered. And you can look those scriptures up. The duration of this dispersion, they're dispersed today, as in James chapter 1 we mentioned, and in the word until in Hosea chapter 5. You might want to write down Hosea 6, verse number 2. Read that too in your Bible study. But especially read Luke 21, 24. Luke 21, 24. That is a very powerful verse where Jesus Christ spoke of this prophecy of their dispersion, that they'd be scattered throughout the earth. And by the way, I used to have a calendar that showed, I used to have a documentation that showed where each country in the world and how many Jews were in each country. By the way, it's no big secret why Jews do real well financially. You got Jews in Argentina who know what they products they have down here, and there's Jews up here, and a lot of them are family, tribal, okay, you know, they're connected. And so they know what a product up here. So if you're needing pulp, you're needing some kind of wood or some kind of metal, whatever up here, and you got a market for it, they're interconnected that way. Diamonds, precious metals, all of your beef processing is pretty well owned by Jewish people. I mean, I'm telling you something, folks, you would not dream about. One of the reasons is because they're international. They are in every nation, and they're inside track. They know what's going on, and they know where markets are, and they watch the political winds. You can go back to the Rothschilds. Nathan Rothschild in England, at the Battle of Waterloo, it was thought that England was going to lose the battle, and everybody was getting ready to do what was going to happen in England, and the stock market in England, they watched Nathan Rothschild at his post there in the stock exchange situation to look at the look of his face, okay, seeing if he knew what the battle was. He had messengers stationed from the battle clear back to him, secret messengers, so he would know before anybody else knew in England which way the battle went. What people were watching for, they thought if his face, this is called smarts, okay? They watched his face. They said, if he looks down, sell your stocks quick. Because if he looks down, if he looks like it's bad, that means we're losing. Get out of the stock market fast before it crumbles, okay? And then If he looks real good, buy, because we've won and stocks will go up. You know what he did? He did have his line of communicators, but he played the trick on them. You know what he did? He looked down. And everybody sold and he bought. And he almost bought the wealth of England in one day. Everybody in the country sold their stocks and he just swept them up for nothing. I'll tell you something. If you want to have fun, just read the history of the Jewish people and always keep it in perspective of the Bible. And it will, you cannot doubt what the Word of God, it'll just ring your bell. And so what I'm saying is this morning is that they were in dispersion there. And they're around the world. Number four, the condition of Israel in this age, this is important. Individually, they are no different than Gentiles. For there's no difference, the Bible said, Jew and Gentile, they have to be saved just like you have to be saved. They're not saved just because they're a Jewish person, okay? All right, a remnant is being saved in this time. By the way, there's a lady who's been, I promise you, she listened to this message. She listens to every message that goes over the internet, Sister Pitts. She's a Jewish lady back in New Jersey. Her mother is 80-some years old, I think, her father, and they're not saved. And she's been communicating with us and writing to us to pray for her folks to be saved. How in the world this girl got saved? And she talks about her pastor thing, but she's classic Jewish people in America. And here's the interesting thing. All of her family, all of her relatives are liberal, just almost anti-Jesus Christ Jews. And yet here's this girl that got saved. Just sovereign grace, a remnant's going to be saved. That's what the book of Romans. Now you write down, read Romans 11. All right. So the remnant's being saved. Nationally, though, they're blinded. Blindness has happened in Israel, Romans chapter 11, in part to the fullness of the Gentiles come in. Brother Sharp preached on that last week. They are set aside. They are not cast away. You need to get that. That is important. How many is going to do me a favor and read Romans 11? Raise your hand. Would you? I'm going to make that commitment. I'll read Romans 11 with this handout. I will get this down. Do it, do it, do it. Please do it. If you don't, the reason we're in trouble in America is because we're trying to run this country without reading our Bible. Number E, they're still the heirs of the covenants. Now, number five, I'm going to finish this up. We're about done. The light went on. The predictions of the future restoration of Israel. The time of the restoration will be in the latter days, Hosea chapter 3. It'll be immediately after the tribulation of those days when Jesus Christ comes back, when the nations of the world are gathered against Jerusalem, and the Lord comes back from heaven. It'll be completely dark. There'll be a light. The Lord Jesus Christ will come and he will destroy those armies. And the Lord Jesus Christ will set up and they will be restored. By the way, they will see him whom they pierced. They will then at that time know that Jesus Christ is truly Messiah. They will receive him as a nation. And so all Israel shall be saved. It will be complete and it'll be permanent. And you can read those scriptures. Number six, the future position of a restored Israel to the world. Israel will be regenerated. Ezekiel, that's the valley of the dry bones vision in the book of Ezekiel. Man, if you want to know about the whole history of Israel, read the valley of the dry bones. Israel will be a blessing to the world. They'll be the head of the nations and they will be the dwelling place of God there in Jerusalem. And Israel's mission will be his glory among the Gentile people. We're going to pick the rest of this up tonight. It's afternoon. And I'll tell you what, we just cannot let folks beat us to the restaurants. Amen. I'm going to make a little deal right here. When I was 25 years old, had I walked into a church and the preacher had preached on this, I would have probably said, what in the world is he talking about? It would have not had any meaning to me. And that's what's called a blind Gentile. Has no earthly idea why America's been blessed, why he can have an opportunity to own a farm or have a job or drive a truck or do anything else. He don't have a clue. And why everybody in the world wants to come here is because of blessings of God, because America. Oh, you know what I ought to do tonight is bring this segment on Harry Truman where he tells about Chaim Weizmann coming in the back door of the White House while he was president and talking him and Harry Jacobson, talking him into supporting the rebirth of the nation of Israel. Oh, and you ought to hear about him talking. Richard Nixon loading up all the planes in spite of all his staff saying, don't do it, don't do it. You're going to get the Arabs mad at us. He said, I'm let them be mad. Load every plane we've got and send Israel goods and arms. America was, you say, well, those guys are, so I don't like Harry Truman. I don't like Richard Nixon. Don't have a thing to do with that. They're still in the palm of God's hand. And that's what gives me hope. That Barack Obama's still under control of Almighty God. Let's stay and go home. Almost started preaching the second half. Listen, you can know all about Israel being restored and dying and go to hell too. You've never been saved.